How are you feeling about the actual, pretty much nailed down secretaries of departments, Attorney General Holder and Daschle for Health and Human Services? Sorry, Howard. I don't know if that's that stings or Daschle's just the consensus man to get move some health care through. And I guess the argument was Dean would have been too partisan. I don't know how those two look. If you're trying to see where Obama's steering his course, I don't know if you want to start with MG or.
Yeah, I mean, that's certainly the argument for Dean. Of course, you know, who's more partisan than Rahm Emanuel?
Mm-hmm.
Nobody.
Right.
So those individual issues, I mean, you know, who he doesn't have the congressional experience. We need someone who can work with the Congress. Well, I mean, they're talking about tapping Janet Napolitano from Arizona for, I think they just did. I forget for which. Well, don't have a little cheat sheet here. And she certainly doesn't come with that either. So, you know, I think the decision to pass over Howard Dean was about Howard Dean and not about any particular category. And I am concerned that there's going to be a thanks for all your help, Howard, don't let the door hit you in the ass on the way out, which would be a real shame because he continues to have a lot to offer. And frankly, not just the Democratic Party, but the whole country owes him a tremendous debt of gratitude for what he's done for the 50 state strategy and the mm-hmm. and the benefits that it's already created and
Obama campaign basically enacting his game plan.
Well, or even coming in on top of it. I mean, they sort of there were a lot of things that went right with that with that campaign, but certainly the 50 state strategy laid the foundation. And then, Obama bringing in enough money to be able to target things the way he did. And frankly, having such a dragged out primary meant that he had to go state by state to build organizations
ground
everywhere.
Game everywhere. Yeah,
yeah. I mean, yeah. He owes Hillary Clinton as much, you know, for forcing him to do that.
Right. Let's see. Shall we move to the state where it just looks like a little bit of, rerun, stagnation. On top of that, we have this, is it $60 million deficit projected, which sounds just like chump change when we're in the world of 700 billions, but that's actually,
chump change for Vermont.
Right, that's a significant number. I see a gas tax getting floated. I mean, from the legislature is gonna be a new speaker. I don't know what the legislature does, reintroduces previously vetoed, are there any previously vetoed bills that you'd like to see come back up, or is there any way to get creative without spending a lot of money, or do we just move into this, you know what, deficits don't matter, we're in hard times, we need to create some jobs here. It just seems like incredibly tricky. You were advising the legislature.
Well, cutting spending is problematic at a time like this, especially because cutting spending always goes to the social services, always the people who are going to be most vulnerable mm-hmm. in a downturn. I forget who said it the other day. Somebody was making a joke about how they say there are no atheists in foxholes, and during a depression, everybody's a Keynesian, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you step back and sort of broadly, intellectually, non-ideologically tagged basic economics say, you know, when you have a downturn like this, the government needs to take up the slack. You shouldn't be talking about rolling back spending too much.
Right.
Because the government becomes this is the federal level, but really also at the state level, becomes an engine to keep things going until things turn around.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Republicans, since the Reagan era, are always talking about rolling back money, about cutting spending on everything.
Right.
Every time is time to cut spending. Deficit. When you're doing well, we're doing well, we got to cut spending. You know, when you're doing badly, well, we're doing badly, we've got to, you know.
Then deficits
ideological
explode
bent.
Under them as well. It's an amazing magical yes. combination.
Although that's certainly not true in the state. I mean, the dynamic has been for some time now that deficit spending is a bad thing. You've got a lot of folks on the left, particularly, progressives. Anthony Polina's campaign was talking about, getting rid of the capital gains loophole. They're looking on the revenue side.
Mm-hmm.
That's going to be a really hard sell now, and rightfully so. We need to watch increasing taxes on anybody when everyone's losing money right and left.
Right.
You know, having said that, obviously I'm a firm believer in progressive taxation, but I think, as you say, it's much more important to keep these programs, to keep people supported during an economic downturn. And if that means deficit spending, I don't think it should be. And I think a lot of folks would say it shouldn't be a taboo. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can go into deficits under serious economic downturn and then start paying them off.
Right.
And that's certainly a classic cycle, but I don't know that we're going to hear that. I think that there are lines that people are going to be afraid to cross. So I don't know what they're going to do, and I don't know what the governor's going to say. I mean, the governor's going to take advantage of the opportunity to start pushing the same old programs, the same old things that he would like to do, you know, permit reform and attacking, you know, Act 250 in ways that will encourage certain types of uncontrolled growth and uncontrolled development, because it's what he always does, it's what he wants to do, and he'll simply use this as an excuse to do that again. I think that's already started. But as far as real solutions, I don't know if he's going to have any, and it's going to be something to see what the legislature comes up with.
Yeah, I guess my concern is I can sort of already see the if the Democrats and Progs move into this. Don't worry about deficits now. Times are rough, and the government needs to keep things moving. That seems to just play right into the Republicans' argument of the tax and spend liberals. I think a lot, but one of the reasons why Vermont moved from Republican to Democrat so strongly is that the Republican Party got to be seen as the party of deficits, and then Clinton came in and was Mr. Fiscal Responsibility. And I just think there's something in this sort of New England soul that has this,
sure. And you never say don't worry about deficits. I mean, you never not worry about it when you go into debt.
Mm-hmm.
But I do think there's an opportunity there to control the conversation.
Right.
And, you know, if people are feeling generally stable and comfortable, at the end of the day, deficits and debt are an abstraction to people. If you approach it with a plan to come out of it,
right,
it's less of an issue.
Right.
And alternately, if you turn that around and you say deficits, schmeficits, this guy wanted to cut off your unemployment. This guy wanted to cut your, you know, special ed. This guy wanted to cut these services that you need. You know, what's more important to you? Where do we choose to control the conversation? We let them control it over this abstraction, or are we going to talk about real people and real impacts and what they really need? And, you know, if we can get over there with pride and stay there and be confident and comfortable in our messaging, then we will always win that argument. The problem is that we're not comfortable in that messaging, that there's a sort of economic inferiority complex so much since the Reagan era about all deficits bad, social services, they seem really nice.
But free market. The government out of the economy. And so you take a bill out, but it turns out the government prints the money.
And so you get these people in there, you know, we're good, smart people, and you know, they intellectualize, you know, this sort of progressive liberal approach to economics and spending, but they feel a little shaky about it. So you put the squeeze on them and they go, and it's because they've internalized all this crap. We had deprogram.
Yeah, we are, the era of free market fundamentalism is over. I mean, that argument is long dead and gone.
It'll be back.
Socialism for the CEOs looks like it's an amazing turn of events. But I think you're right, there's sort of this residue of those arguments since Reagan, the sort of Milton Friedman school is it's still looming.
We need to get over the progressive economic inferiority complex that we all have to
the government's
the conservative grown-ups.
Regulations are the problem. I mean, that argument seems outrageously dead now.
Yes, well, we certainly have a nice jump start to moving beyond, because yes, even the most hardcore, well, not all of the most hardcore folks, but folks are.
Yeah, although there is that sort of diluted, I don't know what percent, that believes that, you know, Acorn is at fault for the economic crisis, and and somehow